Okay, welcome everybody to our plenary session, the title of which is Institutional Responses to Generative Artificial Intelligence in Learning and Teaching. It has been 533 days since the public release of ChatGPT on November 30th, 2022. And I know that because I asked ChatGPT how many days it's been since the public release of ChatGPT. Yes, it told me it's been 5,000 days. It wasn't the first generative artificial intelligence tool that was made available for public use, but it was the first that used a large language model to gain widespread attention and use from ordinary consumers, including our own students and our own instructors, and even some curious administrators. It quickly became a matter of concern in higher education across Canada and other parts of the world, driven mainly by questions about the potential disruptive effects of the technology on learning, teaching, and academic integrity. Generative artificial intelligence, specifically tools that use large language models, have implications for a broad range of activities in higher ed, research, administration, and of course, learning and teaching. Those implications affect academic integrity, but they go beyond that. GAI has created opportunities for new forms of learning and teaching. It's also disrupted past practices and assumptions. Universities throughout the world are adapting to this new technology. They're creating and revising policies. They're striking task forces. They're appointing special advisors, developing support and guidance, and leading conversations about how the ways we learn and teach may be changing. Universities are also facing pressures to respond to the emergence of these technologies. We are peppered with solicitations from hundreds of new AI edtech companies promising exciting new tools to change the way universities teach students. So, to help us understand how universities are responding to GAI in learning and teaching, we've reached out to our neighbors in the sector. We are grateful to have on our panel today Vice-Provosts from York University and the University of Toronto, here to share their experiences adapting, adjusting, and responding to all the challenges, opportunities, and disruptions that GAI has brought to higher education in the past 533 days. So let me begin by introducing our panelists. On the far end here, we have Susan McCann, the Vice Provost Innovations in Undergraduate Education and Vice Provost Academic Programs at the University of Toronto. Susan was recently appointed as Provostial Advisor on Artificial Intelligence. Previously, she was Vice Dean Undergraduate in the Faculty of Applied Science and Engineering. She's a professor in mechanical engineering who specializes in thermodynamics. Her current area of research is engineering education. Susan's a fellow of the American Association of Advancement in Science and is the past president of the Canadian Engineering Education Association. We are also joined by Chloe Brushwood Rose, a professor of education from York University, my former home institution and a colleague of mine. Her research interests bridge several fields, including community engaged media and arts education and gender, feminist, and sexuality studies. Chloe is currently serving as York's Vice Provost Teaching and Learning. So thank you very much for joining us, and we're looking forward to hearing what you have to share today. And we're going to begin by asking our guests just to spend a few minutes outlining some of the highlights of your respective institutional responses to generative artificial intelligence in learning and teaching. And we'll start with Susan.
Thanks very much. So I think like many institutions, we had people who were experimenting around the edges with AI before November of 2022. But obviously, November, you know, I learned of ChatGPT when I teach first year design. My students are very tech-philic. A group of them came running up to me at the front of the class and said, "Hey, Professor McCann," shoving a phone in my face, "look at what this thing does on your assignment." It's like, cool. Great. Thank you very much for that. Now I know what I'm going to do for my holidays. So I spend a lot of the next month, of course, reading up quite a lot on this. There is a real, you know, fear of missing out here, as I think our speaker this morning pointed out. And so we've taken very much what I would call a fast, slow approach. which is very quickly we got a set of FAQs, some guidance for our faculty out and up onto websites. That came out end of February, beginning of March 2023, and was quickly followed by a set of syllabus language in time for courses in summer courses in 2023. We started doing lots and lots. I'd started doing lots and lots of presentations for just everybody under the sun at the university, and little video demos of things and trying to explain the technology and what it does and what it does not do. Since then, we've developed guidance for graduate supervisors on the use of it in graduate studies. Our library has, you know, websites on copyright and guidance around the use of IP with this. We put out grants for people who are experimenting with it. But much of this has been traveling around the university and listening to people and their concerns. What are they trying? What are they seeing in their classrooms? And understanding it from many different perspectives. As Sean mentioned, we've just started a task force, and this is kind of the slow part, is we did not race to start a task force on this. It's just getting going. We've met once so far, working groups in many different areas, including operations, IT, data governance, administration, research, teaching, to start to unpack the interpretation of our policies and what new kinds of guidance we need for people based in principles and values for the university going forward. So that's basically where we are at. I think we've learned a lot over the last year. But one of the takeaways, I think, is right now, and the speaker this morning, Bonnie, talked about this, we are in sort of the Yahoo era of this technology. We're not sure yet if it's going to, we're pretty sure it's going to be something, but we're not sure what that something is quite going to look like yet. If we can't manage the hallucination aspect of this, it may be somewhat limiting. If we can figure that out, it may be very different. And so trying to figure through, like, not getting caught up in the hype, but actually taking a very pragmatic and principle-based approach to this is what we are aiming for. Thanks.
Thanks, Susan. Chloe, what's been happening at York?
About AI. Lots has been happening at York. Hi, everybody. And thanks, Sean, for the invitation to be here today. I think one of the things I want to start by saying is that, you know, when I to be asked about an institutional response suggests that we've responded, and we are still responding. I mean, I think it's an ongoing process. We are still trying to understand how we should respond, I think. And as I mentioned to Susan earlier, it's one of those moments as an administrator who's a faculty member who is doing this job as an administrator for a while, where you realize, you know, you're in a leadership role and you really enjoy leadership, but suddenly you're asked to lead on something that you may have no expertise in, right? And this is the reality of our institutions, is that we collectively run them and we only have the knowledge we have. And so so part of responding to Gen AI is really improving our own literacy about this. And that's something that's ongoing for me. Susan certainly has a lot more expertise than I do in the sense that it's been part of her work for a long time. And so I think we need to turn to colleagues like that to ask them for advice. And I have looked a lot at what U of T and TMU and other institutions are doing. And I think that's really important. In terms of the highlights of our response so far, I think there are kind of two dimensions. So one is about the sort of principles we've gravitated toward, and the other has to do with some specific initiatives. So in terms of principles, we really taken from the very start a very principle-driven approach. We want to be principle-led. We want to take an approach to Gen AI that's really aligned with York's core values, especially values of social justice and equity. And I think importantly, we're not taking a prohibitive approach to Gen AI. We while we did initially begin that way, as many institutions did, in response to the sort of initial panic, I think we're trying to really take a different approach, because we just feel simply that a prohibitive approach won't work. I mean, that the horse has left the barn, as they say, in the other people say, and now I say, apparently. So we're really trying to focus on literacy and conversation and do that kind of work. In terms of initiatives, I think there are three kind of key ones. So one area that York has actually been leading in, I think, is the development of our own Gen AI tools that we can use internally that create greater security around data for researchers, students, faculty, and so on. And so we're developing a platform that leverages OpenAI GPT-4 to do that, that provides secure use. We've also been developing some AI tools that integrate with our learning management systems to help with course design and assessment and so on. So that's an interesting area that's really coming out. That work is coming out of IT, but I collaborate quite closely with that. Second, we have a really robust community of practice that was initiated by our teaching commons on Gen AI pedagogies. And that community of practice now has well over 200 members who are actively engaged in sort of ongoing discussion, who meet up regularly and collaborate to share resources and explore best practices and so on. And I think that's really actually quite exciting, because that's, to me, where real change and innovation is going to happen. And finally, it's interesting, York had a task force on AI and society in 2018. So before the ChatGPT, interestingly, a lot of it's quite relevant. Like, I think that task force, which was sponsored by our, Vice President Research and Innovation, did some really interesting thinking around AI across the institution that's been very helpful to us. We recently had a task force on the future of pedagogy, which also took up the question of AI, especially in relation to teaching and learning. And among its very minimal, it only made 5 recommendations. And one of them was a very strongly recommendation for to enhance Gen AI literacy among students and faculty. So that's the work I've been doing in my office, which is, you know, to work on a series of web-based resources and other kinds of resources to share with students and faculty. And we look forward to launching those in the fall. So we're a little behind some other institutions in terms of what we've provided to the community, but I've been very grateful to learn from the example of some other institutions. And we hope that once we launch in the fall, we will have some good buy-in. As Sean will remember, York is a culture of a great deal of consultation. So it's been very important for us, I think, to have conversations with the community before posting public guidance. Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's only sporting that I share some of what TMU has done for you to hear, and also maybe some colleagues here to get some sense. And I'll do that briefly, as I know we also have a session later today, I believe, where you'll have an opportunity to learn a little bit more. But we've had very similar experiences. There was activity before November 2022 at TMU around concerns about artificial intelligence. Our Senate Learning and Teaching Committee had already been taking up some questions being led by the Academic Integrity Office about Grammarly and other writing assistance tools. Obviously, post-November 2022, things changed quite significantly. We had also started up a community of practice to create a space for colleagues to be able to talk to each other about what the technology is, how it's affecting their teaching, how they might adopt, or respond. Over the past year, the Center for Excellence in Learning and Teaching has kind of been the core leadership around the institutional response through our Generative AI Working Group, which is I think of it as like the Voltron of the center, digital media projects, educational developers, instructional designers, curriculum specialists, academic integrity specialists, all together working on the development of resources and supports across the university. One of the first of which was the development of our initial guidance that we published in the fall of 2023. And over this past year, we've been working with the Senate Learning and Teaching Committee to revise that guidance into more robust guidelines based on what we've seen over the course of the year in terms of what's happening at other institutions, how the technologies have changed as well. And we worked with our colleagues in the Yates School of Graduate and Postdoctoral Studies on providing guidelines for thesis and dissertation work as well. But there's more work ahead for us. Task forces, perhaps. Policy changes, perhaps. So we're looking forward to having a little bit more of a discussion here about this. So what we wanted to hear from you next was about ways in which your faculty may be adopting generative AI in their teaching practices. Are there examples of innovations in learning and teaching with Gen AI that you might want to share?
Sure. I mean, I'll share just a couple because I think a lot of people are doing some similar things. A couple that are kind of interesting. One was a project that was actually started before November 2022. It was a faculty member who was working directly through OpenAI to personalize reflection prompts. So the student would, these were students who were trying to decide on a program of study. They would express something about their interests and who they are and so forth. And instead of the chatbot telling them which program they should be in, the chatbot would respond to that with a personalized reflection prompt that would help the student then reflect on what program they might want to choose. So again, rather than giving the answer, it helped, it was more along the lines of guidance. And that they were working on that before ChatGPT came out. But I thought it was a really interesting example in a very large class. Normally we might just ask people to reflect and we just give them a generic prompt. I thought that was an interesting one. I think another interesting one is I was saying at lunch that our friends in computer science got hit with this about 6 months before everybody else because GitHub Copilot came out about 6 months ahead of ChatGPT. And one of my colleagues last year published a textbook on learning AI-assisted Python. And so very quickly jumped on this to say, you know, our students are using GitHub to learn computer programming. How do we help them learn computer programming with knowing that this is in existence and is readily available? And was able to get that book out very quickly with the help of both a co-author and ChatGPT to in the development of the book. So I think there are some interesting examples, and then there's the sort of the usual ask GPT to do the assignment, give it to your students to critique kind of things. But you know, at a place the size of the University of Toronto, if you ask me, is somebody doing X, I say probably 10 people, and I don't know any of them. But it is always the case that there are things going on all over the institution. Our grant program was very helpful in pulling in some really interesting examples that we could then share across the institution with others. And we treated that as a cohort that worked together for the last year.
Chloe?
Yes, I share. This kind of question is hard because I know so much is happening, but I unfortunately don't get to hear about a lot of it. But I do, and I think many of the things that faculty are doing at our institutions are happening here. I think faculty are actually working in quite similar ways across the sector. So I think one of the pieces in terms of teaching has been finding ways to build critical digital literacy skills in ways that really connect with course topics and disciplinary skills. So, and I'm sure that you've experiencing that here. So how, what are the discipline specific kinds of teaching that can happen? And so, you know, using Gen AI to generate materials as discussion starters, as part of active learning, if you're not using it for actual assignments, building it into the student research process for a course. So I'm thinking here about, and this will probably be a familiar example to you, a humanities course in which students are encouraged to kind of compare the usefulness of Gen AI tools with their own unassisted work for things like annotated bibliographies or reverse outlining or article searches, things like that. And I know this is happening in lots of other places. And I think there's also the piece around faculty using Gen AI to assist them with teaching tasks. So that's the other piece. And we were talking at lunch about how, you know, we've been worried a lot about how students use it, but we haven't maybe been as worried or thoughtful as we should be about how faculty are using it. And so the use of Gen AI and assessment and things like that. But there are some, interesting ways that's being used. to draft case scenarios, to draft rubrics and assignment instructions and things like that. And there's one example where a professor is using ChatGPT and to generate material for assignment that, so when he noticed that he was receiving AI generated essays and was doing a ton of work to fact check them and sort of carefully unpack, he thought, why don't I have the students do this? And so he reverse engineered the assignment. And instead of having them generate essays, he generated essays, you know, through ChatGPT, and he has them fact check and them, you know, read through and carefully kind of unpack the essay. So I think that that's quite an interesting use, because in a way, if ChatGPT can write for us, then the skills we do need are these skills around fact-checking, around information literacy, around how to identify hallucinations and so on. So I thought that was an interesting example.
It's giving me some ideas here. This is so Susan, you had spoke a bit about the grant program. I was curious if there were other ways in which your institution is supporting adaptations to Gen AI technologies, ways in which you're supporting colleagues with rethinking assessment methods, and if there are any disciplinary areas in which the technologies are proving to be more disruptive or less disruptive?
Sure. Yeah, we're certainly running workshops, drop-in center. We have a weekly drop-in sessions for faculty, whole variety of things. We now, of course, our Center for Teaching Support and Innovation has a page up on Gen AI, helping faculty rethink their assignments, assessments, and their teaching materials and how they want to approach things. We do have faculty who are reverting to more in-person assessment or thinking about having students do things outside of class, but then come in and do a little bit of something in class, that or submit a 2-minute video with their assignment to review, things like that. So I wouldn't say that it's one particular field. I think it's very varied across fields where we're seeing concerns arise about the way in which the technology is being used. But literacy is a huge, huge issue. And I think I've given talks now to something like a third to a half of all faculty at the University of Toronto. There's about between 3,000 and 4,000 faculty at U of T, right? So it's enormous. And even now when I give a talk, I think there's a few people in the room that still think that this is just mashing up ideas off the internet. Then when you put in a prompt, it's going and finding ideas and it's mashing them up to give you the answer. And understanding that that's not how it works, once you can get your head wrapped around how it does work, then you can start to make informed decisions about assignment and assessment design. But it is the case that I think we still have a lot of work to do on some of the basic literacy of just how this works. And it's complicated because every week something new comes out and, oh, now it is searching the web, right? Yes, but the underlying technology isn't. It's just using it to augment your prompt. So we're sort of trying to swim up a very fast moving current here.
Chloe, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I love the idea of the grants you've been offering, and we haven't been doing that. I wish we could. That's something I will continue to advocate for, because I think it's very important, actually, that we invest in faculty expertise around this. And like Susan, and I'm sure here, you know, same, we're offering workshops, the community of practice is very active. There's an AI and education course, various events in collaboration with our academic integrity officer. We held a summit on AI in higher education in October, where several faculty presented and were able to have conversations with each other, there's individual and departmental consultation, things like that. I would like to be able to support, I think, more centrally the innovation with this new tool, you know, especially because we need to find creative ways to use it well. I haven't really seen assessment methods being revisited beyond the individual course level. So individual faculty are doing that, but there hasn't been a programmatic response yet. But I think, yeah, as you said, more faculty are moving toward sort of more scaffolding, more process-oriented assessment strategies rather than relying on sort of traditional high-stakes assessment methods, which is probably pedagogically good also, increasing formative assessment and so on. And I think it's disrupting all fields. I mean, but I think especially around student learning and student work, I feel like the fields that have relied on the traditional written essay are really facing the most challenge, that, the sort of humanities and social sciences, perhaps, where you have students, handing in these final essays, year after year, that is really being disrupted in a profound way. And we had really interesting conversation over lunch about how it's possible for colleagues to get together and make different choices about how students learn in their disciplines. And I think that that's work we need to do. And yeah.
If I could just add one note to that, one of the things we've been encouraging is suggesting to departments that maybe they kind of split up into dyads or triads, and each one take one piece of this technology to kind of explore and then teach back to the department. Maybe it's one tool, maybe it's one type of assessment, maybe it's one, whatever it is, but you're more likely to do it if you're teaching it to others in your department, and it helps to build that expertise in the department without sort of making it everybody's job to learn everything.
So I do have to ask about academic misconduct. It in some ways has been the entry point, I think, for many universities and colleges for thinking about generative AI. I guess in your views and in the way in which you've been responding at your institutions, what do you think have been some of the more effective approaches to addressing academic misconduct involving generative AI technologies? Have your institutions updated policies or practices?
Do you want to go first on that one?
So I will just say that we've landed in a place, as I think I sort of indicated at the beginning, where we really do see the best approach to addressing academic misconduct as education, which is the same in other areas of academic misconduct. That's always been our approach. We've moved away from a focus on detection and prohibition, and instead are trying to focus on other kinds of strategies, including educating students and faculty. I think the initial fear around Gen AI fueling a huge increase in cheating within higher education prompted many institutions, definitely including York, to quickly produce statements that the student use of AI tools would be considered cheating, right? So we had this sort of initial response that came out. Of course, statements like this lack nuance, and they unfortunately, I think, place decision-making on instructors who themselves may not be well-informed about the capabilities of these tools. And so I think that we've stepped back from that initial statement, and we're trying to focus on education. And so in a number of ways. We are also, which I could speak about if there's time at the end or if people are curious, but we're also working on a new academic conduct policy, and that's actually been in the works pre-ChatGPT, which again won't surprise Sean. Policy at York takes a very long time.
Ours is super fast.
So, I mean, that seemed frustrating at first, but then it's been wonderful because we've actually been able to modify the language before it goes to Senate, which I hope it will happen next month, actually. And so the new language that we've written into the policy really foregrounds transparency as central to academic integrity. So if passed, this new academic conduct policy sort of indicates that uses of Gen AI will only be considered cheating if they're explicitly prohibited, okay, by an individual instructor or program, or are unreferenced and undocumented. And so the focus is not only on education, but then on how do we document and reference our use of this tool? How do we cite it? How do we say, I had Gen AI help me with this piece of the project? And so going forward, if this is what, Senate approves, then that will kind of be the approach. So individual instructors will still be able to prohibit the use of it if they want to for particular assignments or courses. But ultimately, you know, we understand that people want to use this tool. And so how can we use it ethically and transparently? And I think this is not out of line with how I know the Tri-Council in terms of research has taken a more strict approach, but I believe there's also been room made for documentation of the use of this tool in different contexts. So I think it's in line with some of those discussions.
Yeah, that's what the journal Nature says, is as long as you document it. At U of T, we defined it early on as use of an unauthorized aid. So rather than saying it's plagiarism, because it's not exactly, we defined it as an unauthorized aid. And by default, if it's not an authorized aid, it's an unauthorized aid. but very quickly, you know, it became, well, you know, we don't say on our syllabi that you can use the internet. We don't say on their syllabi you can use a word processor, spell checker. So we encourage our faculty to be very explicit on the syllabus. We don't require them to be, but we basically say if you're not explicit, it's, you're going to have a hard time. If you, you know, somewhere it's got to be explicit on your assignment instructions or something, if you don't want people to use it, or if you want them to document or something like that. I think one of the conversations we've been having with faculty is, this is like, in some sense, like collaboration. Some of our students were privileged enough to have parents who would proofread their work for them, maybe provide a little too much help. Maybe they have a roommate who provides a little more help than we would like, or a friend group, or, you know, frankly, in engineering, we encourage our students to work closely together and collaborate on work outside of exams, because it's really useful learning. I worry that we are losing the tutoring effect with these, because that tutor is becoming the AI rather than the friend who's going to learn through helping tutor their friend. But when I talk to faculty, I say, how much collaboration is too much collaboration with another human in your class? Okay, so now start thinking about that in terms of where you're drawing the line with AI. Where is it okay to get assistance, and where is it not okay to get assistance? Because none of us learn in a vacuum. We all learn with better, right? Vygotsky's zone of proximal development, with some amount of assistance. But just be very clear and have that conversation with your students about when, because they're going to have to develop a level of wisdom around AI in their life, when they go beyond the university, about when to rely on it and when not to. And you know, one of the sort of funniest stories was back in December of 2022, when, you know, stories were coming out about the woman who asked ChatGPT whether she should get a divorce. It's like, listen, if you have to ask, right? But like, what are you asking AI to do for you? Let's help them develop some wisdom around it. How can you, as an instructor, help students steer through that collaborative thing? So we're trying to turn the conversation from, yes, okay, if you're drawing a line and the student steps over the line, but there, you know, how you help them navigate that line is really important.
Can I add to that, just to say that I think we, you were saying that we like to think universities are very important, and they are important. And they also are a stepping stone for students. They are not, students don't spend their lives here. They come here to have an experience, to learn, to be engaged, but then they must go out into the world and do other things. And what students are telling us, and there's lots of, you know, emerging research on this, is that they are very anxious about the kinds of skills they will need in a work environment where Gen AI will be everywhere. And that, in fact, the types of skills they will need to have in workplaces are changing rapidly, and will be less about content generation and more about a lot of other critical thinking skills, a lot of other kinds of critical literacies. And so I think the other piece of this for me is that to prohibit this tool is to take a very in my view, like not a very student success oriented position. And that for York, where we have such a high percentage of first generation students, where access is so central to our mandate, I really see our ability to help students use these tools wisely, as you said, is like critical to our access mission. And it's critical to postgraduate success and to and to sort of lifetime success. So I think that we get very fixated on our own courses and our own assignments and our own programs. But in fact, our role is to enable futures for our students. And that's, I think, how we need to be framing these conversations.
And I'll just say, I think, you know, and I've said this to my faculty, a little bravery here, is, you know, I think sometimes in the past, we've relied too often on good grammar as a proxy for competency. And if that gets wiped away, then now we actually have to look at real competency.
So I alluded to this in my remarks at the top, but the implications of generative AI for higher education go beyond learning and teaching. It's affecting almost all corners of the operations of the university. And for us at TMU and for the colleagues in the center, this has been a pretty regular refrain. We get questions about learning and teaching, but then we start getting questions about research integrity, administrative uses of AI, student services, how do we validate personal essays and non-academic requirements in applications for programs, none of which are in the purview of the teaching center. So I wondered how the efforts to address Gen AI and learning and teaching at your institutions intersect with these other areas of the university that are responding to generative AI. Are you getting similar questions? You mentioned your task force is now met. That's covering more than just learning and teaching. Are there things you might be able to share about that?
So we've just established an AI roundtable, which is cross-divisional. So it has representation from every university division. So academic, IT, security, legal, research, students, human resources, and so on. And so the goal of this group was and we've met once, and it's co-chaired by myself on the academic side and the CIO, and which I think is interesting. The goal is really that as every division is grappling with this, like student services, right, the registrar's office, security, legal, you know, as we're all grappling with this and trying to write guidelines or think about what the guidelines might look like. We really should be aligned with one another. It would be a shame, you know, it would be a shame to either be working across purposes or to be diverging, you know, that we are in fact a community and an institution. And so the roundtable has been established to make sure that, you know, for example, we as a group reviewed some guidelines around information security. Now that's not necessarily my area of expertise, but I think it's really important that the academic mission of the university be at the table when we're looking at guidelines around information security, just as all these other divisions are. So, and I'm very excited to bring forward our teaching and learning guidance to that group as well, and to sort of see what kinds of views they generate from their various vantage points. It's, you know, helpful to remember that faculty are staff, right? We have this, you know, and human resources reminds us of that. And so I think the more we can work together, the better. And also just because in a way we're all beginners with this technology. And so it seems to me that we need a kind of collective brain, right? Like a collective to make the best decisions possible in this climate. So that's sort of been our strategy. And as I said, we met once. We will see how it goes. That group will report to the and make recommendations and advise the president and vice president's table. So that's the goal, is that it will offer some guidance to the institution as a whole. But it's an evolving situation. Yeah.
Yeah, I've done two talks last year and then again this year at our registrarial annual conference for our registrars, because they are deeply interested in this. And it's not just about, you know, admissions essays essentially being wiped off the map, although that's part of it. One of the first instances of AI we had at the university is we have a mental health wayfinding system called NAVI, which is based on IBM Watson technology. And we've had that for a number of years. And that was in student services, right? So I think there's a great deal of interest in this. And having, as Chloe said, data governance is enormously important. As the speaker this morning spoke about, we're very concerned about our students understanding data. And data now is not just your SIN number and your student number and your name and your birth date. It is every email you write, every piece of writing that you upload for ingestion. And so really understanding that we just went through the process of revamping our notice of collection for the university. And we took the stance of not only revamping that notice of collection, which is often presented to students, you know, on their way into register, because, and of course, they're just going to click through it, right? They're not going to take a lot of time to read it. To really thinking about it as an opportunity for data literacy for students. And so we revamped the whole page we have on collection of student data and what we do with student data around transparency of use. And that will be, I think, critical for thinking through what we allow or disallow or choose to do with AI. Within the institution, foundationally across administration, across research, or across operations in many, many different areas. Yeah.
So we have time for questions from our audience. We've got 15 minutes. We've already got a person with their hand right up, ready to go. So we're going to steal one of the microphones from here. Oh, we've got an extra. Great. Curtis, if you're okay playing Donahue for me, thank you. If anybody got that reference.
Stress for it.
Hi, thank you. So you guys have talked about how like the university's administration is trying to come up with general policies, and then how faculty within their departments are kind of coming up with like little solutions for that work locally. But contract lecturers work for hourly rates and are already don't get enough hours for the hours that they do, and as well as TAs that have like a lot of the marking. So what are the expectations for them? Because like I could have reported over 100 students last semester, but then that's my time, that's too much. Like what are the expectations for us to be upholding these rules and developing on their own when we don't already have enough time?
Yes, I hear you. And it's interesting because I have friends and colleagues who are contract faculty, many other institutions also. And, it is an issue. I was speaking with a grad student of mine who's a contract faculty at a college, and she was saying, I just have to I can see that these are AI generated, but I don't have time, or I'm not paid. My contract doesn't cover that much time. You know, I think it's a very real issue. So, and it's a different kind of issue than it's been in the past. I think academic integrity cases in the past are different than these kinds because of just the sheer numbers and the sheer volume that are possible. So I don't have an answer to say this is how we solve the problem, but I think it is a problem. And I think that this is... yeah, I mean, it's something I think unions also need to be, you know, putting on their agendas as part of the evolving nature of collective agreements and working conditions for contract faculty. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Just on what you were saying, like maybe even something small, like letting contract staff know that like they're not going to get in trouble for not upholding these things. Right. Like let them know at least the basic expectations on them, because people worry about not doing their jobs properly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think what you're speaking to is the, you know, there is a sort of a fundamental angst about having to rethink assessment just across every field. And we're not, you know, we're not at a steady state yet with this technology. I think right now it is not particularly good, and so it does the work badly, and so you can see that it's done the work and you know that it's not the student, and it's not great, right? We don't have a lot of good ways to say we can bring a case forward, right? We don't allow detectors, or our legal folks have said you can't, like detector won't stand up in an academic case. So that's, you can talk to the student, but that takes time to bring the student in and explain their argument and everything. The question for me is, will the technology get better? I think probably the answer to that is yes, at which point it's not going to be crappy first in, or high school level essays. It's going to be reasonably good quality third and fourth year. And it won't be perhaps as obvious what was written by the AI and what was not. And this is going to necessitate a rethinking of how we do assessment. I don't know what the answer to that is yet. I think we have very creative faculty, and we will keep working through it and looking what other, you know, across the world at what people are doing. But it's complicated.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And just to add to that, we had this conversation at lunch that it's really a question of thinking very clearly about what is it we want students in our disciplines to learn? Like, what is the core, you know, what is the core kind of learning we want to see? Because it is critical to assess learning. This is a key part of our work, but it may be that some forms of assessment that we've come to rely on out of habit are no longer going to do that for us, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm thinking through this, I'm realizing that there are probably other technological changes in the pipes that are coming at us right now that many of us haven't seen any better than we saw this coming. And so I'm wondering if there's any thinking about how universities can be more proactive, because it really seems to me that as we work through this, moving from, you might say, kind of our back heels to the front again, we'll probably find some better solutions than we're even thinking of now, but we sure would have been better off if we'd been thinking about them a few years earlier.
I couldn't agree more, and I wish I could have seen the freight train coming. But you know, it was really interesting. One of the first things I did in December of 2022, like after I finished my class and got my grading done, because I need to worry about that first, was I ran over to talk to Jillian Hadfield, who is the director of the Schwartz-Reisman Institute, world-renowned institute in AI. I'm very lucky to be at an institution that has you know, some of the pioneers in this field. And I said to Jillian, did you see this coming? Like, was this something, is what you're seeing in ChatGPT really, really new? Or is it just new to me? And she said, no, it's really, really new. Like, what we saw 6 months ago did not look nearly as coherent and long shot as this is. This is a game changer. So to some degree, we can sort of, again, look to our leading edge faculty who are doing things like that unique reflection prompt work that was going on, you know, 6 months before ChatGPT hit, and said, you know, give us the canary in the coal mine. But there are going to be, I think, moments here where things are going to happen that are surprising for everybody.
I think that there's also a need for institutions to be more clear about what our foundational principles and values are around learning and teaching. And we've had many conversations in the Academic Integrity Office about this, going back and forth about whether or not we need to be more specific in our policy in terms of language about particular technologies, or whether we need to be getting to the core of what it is we're assessing when we validate students' learning. And the conversations has led us to be thinking about whether or not the work a student submits appropriately or adequately represents their knowledge, skill, and ability. And that's the principle, right? Whether someone has had a machine produce work for them, or whether they've paid a family member, not paid a family member, had a family member, or paid a third party to produce the work for them, the principle is that they're submitting work that doesn't represent their knowledge. And so if we can be really clear about what it is we were trying to validate in terms of students learning, and same with the assessments. What is it that we want students to be learning? What is it we actually want them to be doing? Do I want students to be telling me about the causes of the First World War? Is that what I want out of this essay assignment that a robot can do? Or do I want them to be engaging in higher level thinking? Do I want them to be engaging in more creative thinking than what a machine can do? And that's pushing me as a history educator to think differently about the types of assignments I'll be designing.
Just a kind of a second part to the first question there. A lot of us contract lecturers are teaching things like the liberal studies courses, and liberal studies require us to have a paper as a major portion of our course, which means that we're the ones dealing with all of this ChatGPT generated essays, and we have to have that as our thing. So perhaps at the institutional level, what needs to be is that liberal studies needs to be revamped a little bit so that it doesn't emphasize being able to write a paper, because that's not really what we're teaching them in liberal studies courses. I teach science for non-science students, but I have to have a 30 or 40% paper every time.
I'm just trying to make eye contact with members of the liberal studies curriculum committee who are here. So just very quickly, your questions are exactly what the committee is taking up right now. We had our first meeting a couple of weeks ago. We've got another one coming up in June, but I'll let colleagues respond to that as well if you want. Or is it too TMU specific? Okay, so stay tuned. Very good question.
Yeah, I will say that, you know, rethinking what constitutes a paper. I haven't tried it yet, but I'm really interested in potentially having my students submit a dialogue, where the dialogue is perhaps with both maybe team members and an AI or something like that, to look at the, you know, so that it's really explicit, like who did what.
Okay, just looking at time, I think we've got time for one more question, and we've got the microphone over here.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Lori Beckstead from the RTA School of Media, and thank you for your insights. Assessment is huge for all of us in terms of assessing learning outcomes, and when AI can produce something that is meant to assess the learning. So that's an issue for all of us, but there's a second aspect to it. I think for many of us who teach in programs where the outcome is meant to be content creation, so whether it's art or whether it's media production or journalism, writing, you know, et cetera, where the actual, so what we're assessing is a real world situation. And what's going to be happening in the real world is that AI will become part of those production processes. So I just wondered if you could speak to that a little bit. That second aspect of how it's affecting us.
Well, I'll just say that, in these presentations I've been giving, there's one slide that, has a bunch of bullet points on it, as many slides do, about what faculty should be thinking about. But the top of the slide says, how will your students be working in the future?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's sort of, I mean, you said it yourself, that those kinds of creative processes will begin to utilize AI tools, I mean, as a matter of course, and then there will also be very important creative processes that continue not to, right? But I think that I'm no expert in terms of how this is uniquely impacting the arts, but I know at York that our faculty of arts, media, performance, and design is taking this up very seriously. In fact, the dean of that faculty, I would argue, is one of the leaders on our campus around questions of AI. And so I think it will be really interesting actually to see how they begin to generate guidance for their own programs and around especially image generation and video generation. I mean, we know it can, you know, it can generate video now, right? Like video footage. And I mean, it's quite remarkable. But I think this is a huge issue. And of course, it's a big issue in the industry as well. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think your question goes beyond the creative programs as well. Like, I think we're encountering this issue in professional programs, asking that question of what our graduates will be, what will their practice look like when they are in the field? And are they going to be using generative AI tools as professionals? In our law school, we are asking these questions as well in terms of what law practice looks like when you complete law school. Will you be using generative AI in your work? And it will inevitably have to change the way we teach in universities.
I'll just say the same December 2022 was really busy, but I was visiting family and I have a 24-5-year-old nephew who's in an internship. He just graduated a few years ago. And I said, so, you know, do you use AI in your work? He said, oh yeah, every day. And I said, what are you using it for? He's working as an intern and as a financial analyst. He said, oh yeah, we feed in what our client is interested in, who our client is, and it comes back out of thousands of articles, it recommends which 10 things to pay attention to. Is it Apple's last quarterly report? Is it, you know, these papers? Is it this? Is it this? Is a, you know, it's a proprietary system called AlphaSense that my company licenses, and I'm expected to know how to use it.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, it is 2:00 and we're out of time. I want to thank our guests here. I have a couple of non-AI generated gifts for you. And thank you to all of you. And please enjoy the rest of the conference here at TMU. Thanks, everyone.